my presentation in PDF file. Okay, and can you see also visualizer with a pencil? Good, thank you. All right, so let us start our first lecture. So let me briefly describe what it will be, the arrangement for this course. This is not a core course which provides certain essential mathematical technique which you may need in your research, but it's rather an optional overview what you can do using SL2R group. And surprisingly, this group being in some sense one of among simplest is rather helpful and appears and in a lot of different applications, say geometry, algebra, representation theory, mathematical analysis, operator theory. And so I will try briefly introduce this connection, probably skipping a lot of technical details for people who are not interested in. And because this is not a core course, some material will be optional. So it will be probably not presented during the regular lectures. Rather, I will record small bits of video covering one or another topic which may be of particular interest for some people, but not for everyone. And that additional material will not be examinable. So if you are interested in a certain topic, you may watch video and try to learn that stuff. If you're not interested, it will not harm your performance in the examination. So examination will be based just on the material presented during the regular magic lectures, 10 lectures over 10 weeks. And I have placed to the magic website my presentation, something which you will screen during see during the lectures. And there is two files, PDF files. One is one page per one slide per page is mainly to see on the screen, and there is also handouts. This is like that. You have four pages on one page, so four slides on one page. So this is fonts became about 10 points, quite readable, and save paper if you desire want to print it out. Or otherwise, you can use certain electronic device like tablets or e-book reader just to watch with files. Of course, it's not very difficult. If you want, you can print two slides per page from the presentation yourself. So this is will be larger font. So if you need one, so actually, so it's up to you which file to use. They are all identical in the content. So just a matter of how heavy paper became if you print it out. If you have any suggestions, please, if you need something from the learning material, let me know through the magic forum and or by email, and I will try to help you with learning materials. Any questions so far? Okay, so what is Erlangen program and what we are trying to discuss during these lectures? So nowadays, pure mathematics is considered as a kind of intellectual game. So we just take some arbitrary assumptions and then try to deduce consequences, theorems out of these arbitrary axioms. But that approach is relatively recent, probably maybe traced just from 20th century. And before that, say till 19th century, mathematics, all mathematics, was considered as a true reflection, as a universal language of the real world. So people believe what mathematical theorems just represent the absolute truth about our surrounding space and other physical processes. In particular, Pythagoras tried to present his philosophy as everything can be represented by a number. And geometry, in the sense of Euclid, was just theory of how to measure land. And when Newton introduced his calculus, it was designed to describe motion of a planet. So all mathematics was considered as a kind of reflection, something which exists in the real world. And then in 19th century, development of mathematics came to the point where not only Euclidean geometry appeared, but many other type of geometry, affine, projective, conformal, differential geometry was developed. And then people start to ask questions, if Euclidean geometry describe our space, what are objects which are represented by other geometries. So that, if you remember, there is the famous fifth postulate in Euclidean book Elements, which says that for any straight line and any point, there is just unique straight line parallel to the given line. And people was fighting for a long time trying to see, is it really a postulate of the theory of geometry, or it can be proven out of other axioms. And in 19th century, Lobachevsky, Gauss, and Boyer independently came to the conclusion what there is consistent geometry with a fifth postulate being replaced by the assumption what such parallel line may not exist, or there are infinitely many such parallel lines coming through the point. All this non-Euclidean geometry is logically consistent. And so people start to wonder how to treat all these geometries, and is there a certain order in the big zoo of geometries. And there are several approaches to that discussion, which again was developed in the 19th century. The first one is the Riemannian geometry, which used a technique of mathematical analysis, so calculus of infinitesimals, in order to describe geometrical properties. So in Riemannian approach, the geometric set was embedded with particular metric. This is a tensor with two indices, and that represent a certain quadratic form, non-degenerate quadratic form in the tangent bundle of the manifold. And then it turned out what a lot of geometry for such a manifold with Riemann metric can be described in terms of Laplace-Beltrami operator. So the spectral theory of this operator, existence of eigenfunctions, discreteness or boundness of the spectrum, other things, they was related to particular geometrical property of manifold. And initially, the Riemannian approach was connected just to so-called elliptic operators. So this is operators as a classical Laplacian, where we have the sum of second derivative with the same sign. But there is also a possibility in a rather similar way to consider indefinite second order Laplace type operator, namely in two dimensions that became a wave equation. So we have a difference of second order derivative. And that became important again in context of mathematical physics, in particular at the point where people start to consider space not separable from time. So space-time metric in special relativity, Minkowski space-time, just a manifold with this type of indefinite second-order differential operator. For the treatment of the Laplacian, the following technique turned to be very helpful. So initially, this is just the second order operator with just real coefficients, but we are able to use the imaginary unit, complex imaginary unit, square root to minus one, in order to factorize with Laplace operator into a product of two first order differential operator with complex coefficients now. And the advantage, of course, is what we can consider the first order differential operator and functions which are zero solution to this first order differential operator, which is a Cauchy-Riemann operator, are analytical function. So the entire field of complex analysis, functions which are analytic on the in complex variables, became helpful, became available to study geometrical properties. If we will come to the similar technique for the wave equation, of course, this is a difference of squares. You can factorize it in terms of real variables, but as we will see later in our course, it's also helpful to introduce a kind of imaginary unit J, which is square root to one, but J is imaginary unit. It's not minus one, it's not real number one, which square root to one, of course. It's some imaginary unit which is not real but has this property. And then it's again advantages, we will see it in our course, reason why this happened, to have a similar first order differential operator factorization for the wave equation. again, at this point will be worth to introduce the third element, which is like a boundary counter, boundary element between the elliptic and hyperbolic case, between the Laplacian and wave operator. This is the heat operator, the operator from the heat equation, which is a parabolic one. So that division into elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic will be frequent, will have frequent appearance in our course. It will be a recurrent theme, which we will consider often. And actually, at this stage, we may make a guess, an assumption, what if we have previously imaginary unit which square root to minus one, we have that second hyperbolic unit which square root to one, it will be worth to introduce as the boundary between when something which is square root to zero, but it's not zero, it's not real zero, it's some again imaginary unit which square root to zero. So it, for some reasons, it can be denoted by epsilon. So we have that imaginary unit epsilon square equal to zero. But if we will try to use such imaginary unit just in the similar way to factorize the corresponding parabolic equations, we will not succeed really, just because if we will consider again associative, commutative, two-dimensional algebra spanned by one and epsilon as complex numbers are commutative associative two-dimensional algebra spanned by real number one and imaginary unit I. So similarly, if we will consider such a number and try to factorize the heat equation, we will have dx plus epsilon dy times dx minus epsilon dy. So things are going nicely for the first two terms. We indeed have square of second derivative with respect to x. If we will calculate mixed derivative dx dy, so one time it comes with a plus, another time it comes with the minus, so it disappeared. But there is a disappointment if we will try to evaluate what happened to the second derivative of y or any other derivative of y. So just due to that assumption about epsilon, it will be just second order derivative of x. No derivative of y in first order or second order appeared. So in some sense, we see what parabolic case a bit different from elliptic and hyperbolic, which are structurally more similar each to other. And again, consideration of what happened in this parabolic case is a kind of things which we will repeatedly meet in our course. So this is a brief overview of Riemannian geometry. Let us see what are alternatives. Some 20 years later, Felix Klein made his famous inaugural lecture at Erlangen University when he received a post of a professor. And he proposed to classify geometries according to their group of symmetry. And in general, geometry is defined as the theory which study objects which are invariant under a particular transitive transformational group. So that was rather innovative for this time, and somehow that was a very far-reaching proposal. And it's easy to trace roots of this ideas really in very classical development. First of step will be a Cartesian description of geometry as a certain in algebraic term, analytical geometry, when we introduce coordinates and express geometrical statements, theorems, as particular relations, algebraic relation equations between coordinates of the object. So, and then reduction of geometry to algebra reduce any geometrical theorem to a solution of particular system of algebraic equation. In some sense, it's easier and because synthetic approach, which was before Descartes, which we can see in Euclidean geometry, usually requires to building certain additional lines, additional triangles. Synthetic proofs are rather beautiful, but it's difficult to invent such proof if you do not practice much in that particular art of proving geometrical statements. Cartesian approach to analytical geometry simplify things in the sense what you always has coordinates, geometrical statement is reduced to algebraic equation, so you don't need to put any additional construction on your drawing, on your figure, you don't need to put any triangles, just try to solve algebraic equation, but solution of algebraic equation is not simple as well. When Galois showed what theory of solution of algebraic equation is related to particular group of symmetries expressed in this equation. In particular, in this way was demonstrated what equation of order 5 or higher, algebraic equation of 5 of higher order, generally cannot have a cannot be solved in a term of roots and radicals. So there is no formula which presents roots of arbitrary equation of order 5 or higher in term of certain roots and combination of coefficients, as we know it for, say, quadratic equation. So order 5 is different. And then, of course, came the development of by Sophus Lee, who tried to expand the idea of Galois to differential equations. So he just observed what symmetry approach, groups of symmetry for particular equation may be helpful if we are solving not algebraic but differential equation. So just out of that, if we will combine together all that three steps, Erlangen idea of Felix Klein appears indeed to solve geometrical problem or to find or build entire theory, geometrical theory. It's important to identify initial group of symmetries for this problem. It's worth to notice what that Erlangen approach was really fruitful and accepted in physics, especially since the discovery of special relativity. So you may know what special relativity theory can be described as the investigation of invariance of Minkowski space-time, which embedded with Lorentz invariant metric, space-time metric. So in three dimensions, that space-time metric is of the form like that. We have time, and that is really correspond to minus Laplacian on Euclidean space, so second order derivative. So here we have that Euclidean kind of structure, but altogether it make the wave type equation. So that is physical setup for the special relativity in three dimensions. In our course, we will more oftenly consider just the two-dimensional. So here is 1 plus 3 dimensions, so one-dimensional time and three-dimensional space. So in our course, we will oftenly consider the indefinite quadratic form u squared minus v squared, and we may think about this situation as the toy model for one-dimensional time and one-dimensional space. So it's just a simplified version of this special relativity theory. And ideas of invariance or covariance of certain quantities in physics, they are widely applied. Unfortunately, in mathematics, somehow that ideas did not get such a much such a big appreciation. At Wikipedia, at some point, even it was in the article about Erlangen program by Felix Klein, it was a line which said what Erlangen program has just a certain historical value. So people do not consider it as a useful tool in actual mathematical research now. But what I will try to demonstrate in this course, if we will employ these ideas and if we will use them systematically, indeed, Erlangen approach can produce quite interesting result, not only in geometry, but also in functional analysis and function theory in analytical areas. And I am sure what actually it's and not only the possible application. There are much more, and probably at some point you can realize what your own research also has a certain group invariance, certain covariant properties, which may help you to develop your research. So to be specific, in this course we will consider just one particular group, SL2R. There are other groups, say Heisenberg group. I am reading a course on magic course on Heisenberg group in any alternating years. So one year it's about the SL2R, another year it's about the Heisenberg group. There is affine group, it's two-dimensional group, which is subgroup of SL2R. So in some sense it's will be a part of our study here, but it may be treated independently. So affine group is rather important. Quite a lot of result in harmonic analysis can be derived from the property of SL2R or affine group. So, but we will concentrate in this course just on SL2R. And this course can be viewed as a good complement to another magic course on Lie groups and Lie algebras, because we will illustrate general theory for Lie groups and Lie algebras by that particular example of SL2R. So something which you will learn in general terms in the course on Lie groups will be useful here as background for our discussion. We will go further than course on Lie groups. We do not only consider the structure of Lie groups, we also touch the representation theory of SL2R, which is not covered in other magic courses as far as I know. And an advantage of our approach, which is limited to SL2R, to rather simple group, what actually, if you do not attend a course on Lie algebras and Lie groups, you still can follow everything, because instead of general theorems about SL2R, about Lie groups, you may just use particular calculations related to SL2R. SL2R consists of 2×2 matrices. This calculation oftenly not very difficult. So instead of general theorems from theory of Lie groups, you can just apply particular calculation with 2×2 matrices to see what result is true. So one way or another, either you attend this course about Lie groups or you do not attend this course, you still may follow Erlangen program with us. So brief outline how this course will work. So today we will, I spent almost half a lecture, more than half a lecture for philosophical introduction. Now we turn out to basic facts about SL2R. So we will study what is it and how it can be presented. Then we will consider probably in 3 or 4 lectures geometrical properties which follow from Erlangen approach with SL2R. So we will deduce certain geometry, different type of geometry from the structure of SL2R. When we discuss construction of a representation of this group, method of induced representation will be used, and we will see what there are many interesting forms, different forms for this representation. When we will use this representation to build analytic function theory, so a standard result from complex analysis appears as a consequence of Erlangen approach in function theory based on SL2R. And finally, we will turn out to functional calculus and quantization. So again, that the will be probably just 2 lectures. So we will rather detailed and pedestrian at the beginning of the course, but later chapter end of the course will be rather cursory. So it will be just outline what is possible to do, because it's rely on more technical results. So just leaving the essential part without technicalities, provide a rather brief overview what will be possible to do in these directions. Are there any questions at this point? Okay, so let's move to the mathematics. So stop speaking about philosophy, come to the mathematics. So mathematics, SL2R has very simple definition. This is a group of 2×2 matrices with real entries, so A, B, C, D, such that determinant of this matrix is equal to 1. So determinant for our purposes has that simple expression. And it's very easy to see what SL2R is three-dimensional as a set parameterized by real numbers. And it's clear why this happened. We have here four real parameters, A, B, C, D, and one restriction, one condition, what determinant is equal to 1. So 4 minus 1 is equal to 3. So we have three-dimensional manifold in this case. Topologically, it's can be represented as a torus with its interior. So topologically, it's not rather trivial. So it's interior of such a torus, which parameterized by matrices, which we are discussing. The group law on this set is given by matrix multiplication. So if we want to multiply two elements, we simply multiply 2×2 matrices. Matrix multiplication is non-commutative. So our group is non-commutative as well. So it's very easy to see. So if you multiply, say, matrix 0, 1, 0, 0 with a matrix 0, 0, 1, 0, in one way or another, you get different answers. So that group is non-compact. So there is a sequence of matrices. So if we take matrices 1 and 0, for SL2R, we better take 1 on these places. So to have determinant equal to 1, of course. So for SL2R, there is, say, this subgroup parameterized by an integer n. So it's easy to see what these points are isolated and do not converge to any limits in within SL2R. So that provide a demonstration what we said is non-compact. And actually, non-commutative, non-compact group are much more complicated than group which are either commutative or compact. So for commutative or compact group, like a group of rotation for three-dimensional space, some significant simplification in theory follow. For SL2R, this simplification is not possible. And that make probably the theory which deducible from SL2R rather interesting. Because we have matrix multiplication, our group has the identity, of course. It's easy to see what indeed set of matrices with determinant equal to 1 indeed form a group. We have identity, which is just identity matrix. And it's known property of matrices what determinant of a product of two matrices is equal to the product of determinants. To see what if determinant is equal to 1, then two matrices with determinant equal to 1 multiply to a matrix in the same set. So it's closed under multiplication. And inverse, again, from general matrix theory, multiplication, inverse, multiplicative inverse of this matrix is given by the formula on the screen. So quite easy to see what each matrix has an inverse. And if we will place our work in the context of more general Lie group theory, SL2R is the simplest example of semi-simple Lie group. Semi-simple in this context means what only ideals of the Lie algebra, what is Lie algebra we will speak soon, R is a zero or entire algebra. There are no non-trivial ideals of the Lie algebra for SL2R. It's important to see or to mention what SL2R has several different faces. So it's isomorphic to a group SO11. This is a group of 2×2 matrices with complex entries which preserve the complex quadratic, indefinite quadratic form Z1² - Z2². So action on a vector space which preserves such a quadratic form complex is SO11. And also it's a special orthogonal group of pseudo-Euclidean space with dimensionality 2-1, where we have two space dimensions and one time dimension. So this is other face of SL2R. So there are maps, group isomorphism from SL2R to these two groups. So our consideration, at some point we will meet SO11 more closely here, and that special orthogonal group in dimensions 2+1, we will not explicitly tell, speak about it, but that space-time description will regularly appear in our pictures. So the connection of Lie group and Lie algebras. So there is a standard way how we identify element of Lie algebra with one parameter subgroup, continuous one parameter, one continuous subgroup of our group. So one parameter continuous subgroup is parameterized by real numbers and has that group homomorphism property from addition of real numbers to group multiplication. So that is the definition of this space. And it's easy to see what SL2R has a lot of such one parameter continuous subgroup. One of the subgroup of interest will be, of course, this group of matrices with cosine t, sine t, minus sine t, cosine t. So that group will play significant role. It's clear what this is, a compact group. So it will be denoted by K from German, first letter of the German spelling of compact. So that subgroup K is indeed isomorphic to the unit circle, because we have here cosine and sine, which is two pi periodic functions. So really, instead of all real numbers, we have just parameter from the unit circle. We factorize over 2 pi, shift by 2 pi, and we get unit circle. And one parameter subgroup property can be easily verified as well. So if we take such a matrix with another parameter S and multiply matrices in the usual way, then on the first position we will have cosine t cosine s plus sine t minus sine s, and then for second term we get minus cosine t sine t cosine s, then we have minus cosine t sine t. So if you use the trigonometric formulas, that will be the cosine of s plus t, and if we use another trigonometric formula for addition of sines, it will be sine minus sine of s plus t. So group homomorphism for real numbers here is followed just from standard trigonometric identities. And then for every such one parameter subgroup, we can introduce or we try to introduce the derivation. So if we have a parameter t, we just able to do such a transformation, when because g of t plus s is g of t times g of s, g of t can be taken as a common factor, so out of expression. So we will have just such a limit, which is the derivative of our subgroup at zero, at the origin. Assuming that is well defined, denoted by x, we see what the derivative of the one parameter subgroup is with one parameter subgroup under action of one particular matrix. So here again, this is a rather general construction which works for all Lie groups and Lie algebras, but in our particular case, because our group is a group of 2 times 2 matrices, we can just use matrix algebra. Overall, matrix algebra, linear algebra, will be rather helpful and important. So results about linear algebra, results from linear algebra will be used repeatedly to investigate or express property of SL to R. It's again a kind of result from the linear algebra when we differentiate, so value of this limit, which we denoted by S, by x, value of this limit is a matrix with a zero trace. So there is a known expressions relation between trace and determinant of 2 times 2 matrices. So here is a result. Try to consider it as an exercise. Try to demonstrate what indeed with derivative for a matrix with unit determinant will be zero trace. So because we will use that result. We may proceed in the opposite way. We may take some zero trace matrix X and consider the previous identity as a differential equation. So we are looking for one parameter subgroup which has such a solution, which solve this equation, what derivative of g is x times g. And that is first order differential equation. If here x just a real number, you easily recognize the solution will be exponent of x times t. So if x here a real number, that will be the solution. But it's turned out what solution here is really can be verified by kind of a real, by kind of just algebraic transformations. And that algebraic transformations can be repeated not only for real number x, but for any algebra. So whenever we have a set with addition and multiplication, solution of such differential equation in this set can be expressed at least formally as an infinite series of this form, which represent the exponential function. So again, just if you differentiate with respect to t, derivative of t to the power n will be t to the power n minus 1 times n, n cancels with the n factorial, so you get exactly the same power series with x, exactly the same power series multiplied by x. So extra power appears here if you differentiate, so extra powers appear here if you differentiate with respect to t. So the only issue which may happen here, if you consider that infinite series not formally, but if you require certain convergence So when your algebra need to have a topology in order to make sense for convergence of such series. And this is kind of convergence which we do have for SL to R. If we have a matrices, natural topology on this set is given just by entry-wise convergence. So convergence topology on the SL to R will be as follow. So if we have Gn sequence of elements of the form An, Bn, Cn, Dn, and we will tell what it's converged to A, B, C, D, which is element of our group, if each entry converge to corresponding limit. So that convergence of elements is and the group, it means just component-wise, entry-wise convergence for matrices. So this is the topology which we expect here. So that makes sense of this infinite series for SL to R. So we always can build a solution. And that again, maybe not so straightforward exercise in matrix theory, but such theorem exists. So if we exponentiate, if we build exponent from such a matrix with a zero trace, result will be the matrix with unit determinant. So element will be in our group. And finally, let me recall again from the theory of Lie algebras, what Lie algebra is a vector space. So, and we do not consider multiplication on this vector space, although we have matrices, but on Lie algebras multiplication is not very meaningful. Instead, operation of the commutator is meaningful, is important operation. And again, meaning of this commutator for Lie algebra of SL to R. So Lie algebra will be denoted by small Gothic letters SL to R, and this is Lie algebra of the group SL to R. And operation of commutator is taken very literally, just as you multiply matrix X to matrix Y, and you multiply matrix Y to matrix X, and take the difference of two product of matrices. Both products, again, two times two matrices, so you can take the difference. So commutator in our case is very straightforward. So probably this is right time to finish our lecture today. Do you have any questions? Okay, please don't forget to indicate your attendance.